he was one of the brightest consultants I had. So I promised him in the first few months you need to be a senior consultant. You deserve to be promoted to higher level. And I kept that promise before I left. He was promoted to senior consultant level. And he currently heads the medical health technology division of NHS RC. And that division thing very recently was also WHO collaborating center, the fourth in the world, Calabatinium with the government, talking about NHS in the medical device and medical device policy related to WHO collaborating center. And he has been involved in at least, I will not list all of them, 10 task forces, Bureau of Indian Standards Phenomena is in the in the top body in the country. Don't go by any way. Go by the wisdom we have in the community. And he is all over. He has played a very crucial role in developing the National Dialysis Program. That's the Kilimanjaro, Bharat Sarkar Dialysis Unit Center team. And he was the one who was involved in that team. Then the diagnostic scheme was also developed in the division. And three essential medicines also and standardization of equipment. And the division came into existence in another industry. Government of Maharashtra was going to buy ambulances. And they somebody in the government was very smart. Whose name is Nani Aiko Life Movement RC, delivery life for each other. Unless they create a company fully clear, a German company qualified for applying ambulance. And the Ministry of Health got a bit of it and they asked me to send somebody for USA. That somebody was the first person to be part of this division and then we had the whole division coming up. After the investigation, they found it was 3 or 4 times more expensive because of that irrelevant like the ambulance. And then they thought that we should have a division within NHSRC which will set the standards for the equipment which should be purchased by the government, which should be used in the hospital, in the intensive care unit, and in the other center. So they also had various task forces which come out with the standards. Neonatal intensive care unit, which I would say, intensive care unit, almost equipment, intensification care unit, for this kaam ke karan, thousands of crores of government money has been saved because they came up with essential going fancy lighting, lagake, crore rupaye paanch sau equipment. To be there in the equipment and that equipment that government can negotiate. Ki hum ye 10,000 equipment khareedenge pure desh mein government. They can then negotiate. So they reached state of mind based on standards which were not applied in any. So he carried a lot of that information and they are at the cutting edge of technology related to that. So with that, over to you, Mohammed. It's a pleasure to have you again. Thank you.
So first of all, apologies for taking session just the time when you conclude your day, but I'm sure I'll try and make it more entertaining. So how many of you would be future things would be interested in health technology specifically? Kuch log to hain good. So screen ek udhar bhi hai, to jo udhar dekh raha hai mujhe thoda sa ajeeb lag raha hai ki main reach kar raha hai screen udhar ek screen udhar teen lakh to udhar. Anyway, I hope everyone is comfortable with Hindi and I'm going to teach now. Yes, or English is good for the important part. So I basically talk about how policy making in the government sector for how policy, how rules and regulations are coordinated. And I basically talk of how technology intensive policies are made. So if I talk about one of the most technology intensive programs in public health. I hope a lot of you must be interested in public health. So public health is interested in moving on this, so I will try and deviate myself other than that also. Those who are not interested in public health. You? I am an engineer. One of the most technology intensive policy is one of the programs called pre-diagnostic initiative. Under this program, the government of India intends to provide a certain set of pre-diagnostics within public health facilities. So 22 states and union territories have actually started providing under this scheme, providing pre-diagnostic initiative. So if you go to some of the health facilities in Delhi or Andhra Pradesh or say Rajasthan, you will get a certain diagnostic screen. And thankfully we have been a part of this important journey. So after that, so this pre-diagnostic initiative of the diagnostics we baat karte hain has two broad components. One is the pathology, layman terms I'm talking about pathology, but it's actually not pathology, it's in vitro diagnostics actually. So but not being a layman term for an MBA, अब इन विट्रो डायग्नोस्टिक्स वर्ड नहीं कर रहे हैं तो इसकी पैथोलॉजी के अंदर वैसे माइक्रोबायोलॉजी बायोकेमिस्ट्री और एवरीथिंग तो दो काइंड ऑफ थिंग्स एंड देन सेकंड कंपोनेंट इज व्हिच वी वुड इंक्लूड दिस विद रेडियोलॉजी सो टू इंपॉर्टेंट कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ डायग्नोस्टिक्स इज अंडर दिस स्कीम इन विट्रो डायग्नोस्टिक्स एंड रेडियोलॉजी दैट वी आर प्रोवाइडिंग सो ब्रॉडली देयर आर टू वेज ऑफ प्रोवाइडिंग फ्री डायग्नोस्टिक्स इन अ पब्लिक हेल्थ So one method would be, so supposedly if a public health facility happens, they go about two years later, two years later. So if they do not have infrastructure, if they do not have human resources, if they do not have infrastructure, if they do not have equipment, or they do not have a supply chain management, to be able to do this, then सब चीजों की जरूरत होगी. अगर ये सब नहीं है, तो government के पास एक तरीका होता है through public-private partnership. So how many of us are aware of public-private partnership? So So this is basically, this is something we should learn now if we are going ahead. If you want to work, even if in the corporate and if you will work with government, you will have to have a knowledge of PPP. If you work for the government and want to engage the private sector, it is a mechanism how government works with the private sector. So one of the methods is public-private partnership, where we develop tender documents, how tendering happens, and how we select our service provider. Provide free diagnostics in the public health. And the other method is if we want to present our own in-house capacity, then we need to have a certain set of equipment. And in order to have the right kind of equipment, we need to procure those kind of equipment. Right? And once those equipment are with us in our facility, one of the important things which we do is without a public health facility is the maintenance of this. And the third important part is the safety of these medical devices. To ensure the safety of these medical devices. So all of these three things, the important pillars of providing diagnostics have so far been quite weak. But somehow I will discuss with you how we have tried to address all these concerns to procure maintenance and safety of medical devices. And I also briefly touch upon what pathology services work in the system. So this is a broad flowchart how the pre-diagnostic initiative is working. So for those diagnostic sets, the capacity, the skills do not exist in the public health system. So we support adequate skilled human resources, we support adequate reagents and consumables which are required, and then we support for equipment procurement and equipment. And for those tests, for which the capacity within the public health facilities, that is the government hospitals, do not exist, we help the government to digitize this. For example, teleradiology, and discuss how that we started working in public health facilities. We support an insourcing of human resources. So, for example, there is a hospital, I do not have HR with me, I will insource HR from a private provider to help me to do these diagnostics. And finally, it is outsourcing of. will also high-end tests which are low volume, for example, cardiac markers and for example, some of the culture tests. I will outsource to a private party so that they can do it for myself because I do not have the capacity. So one of the key objectives of doing so is to ensure that availability of minimum set of diagnostics is available in every public health facility, and that is free of cost to reduce high out-of-pocket expenditure. So how many of you are aware of this term OOP? You have some economics background? No? So can you tell me something about this OOP? Your introduction, please. All of you know her?
Aware of what the market is.
what we are aiming at is, at the sub-center level, we are providing 7 depositories, yes, and then this is increasing. In the coming months, this number is going to increase. At the primary health center, it is 90 tests. At the community health center level, it is 59 tests. And this will also include X-ray and ultrasound. And 56 tests, including X-ray, ultrasound, and CT scan, and district hospital, treatment level. So this is the number of diagnostics which is being provided under the supported. This already is intended for them. So this is the, these are some of the states where the program is under implementation, and we hope that the implementation strengthens day by day. So the lab services in public-private partnership for Andhra Pradesh is and Delhi. So, teleradiology is one of the important components of the free diagnostic. So, with this name of teleradiology, and so you must be recollecting something. Anyone who has some sort of idea about what teleradiology would be, that who would like to answer? Teleradiology, jab main bolta hu, to kuch samajh mein aata hai? Who wants to answer? One. You know, something.
Basically, sending the reports and sending the details to the physician and over the call or the documents. We can do that.
Your
introduction,
please.
Yes.
Your introduction, please.
As a doctor.
So, yes, good. Thank you. So, basically, the slight difference in understanding between and then you transmit it over the power to a lab where a radiologist back in the future. It also has provision of getting the report in an emergency case. So these are some of the 10 states which have these programs implemented. So in future, if you want to do some study or something, I think these emergency could be quite helpful.
Quickly because I know you are
we have to maintain the safety part is an important part. So all of us know a lot of the radiology equipment that we do, X-ray imaging equipment, and they pose a public health threat challenge, so like we do not use it in a recommended manner. So for example, this is the X-ray room that is recommended by atomic energy. So it has to have a specific thickness, it needs to have lead lining in its door, in its wall, it needs to have a proper chest head. The health worker should be wearing a lead apron, he should have a TNT badge which absorbs X-ray and which is monitored quarterly so that it could tell how much X-ray the health worker has absorbed. Has a lot beyond a certain limit, then he gets a leave or he gets a treatment if it is even more serious. So there are a lot of things that we need to be aware of if we are working in this domain. So under the diagnostic schemes, if we are supporting next year, we are also supporting to ensure that the devices are used in a safe and efficacious manner. We also ensure that the machines are quality assured and calibrated well in time. And the machine which is procured is procured, which is a type of food machine by the government. This is another program that I wanted to talk about at the final few slides. This is the National Dialysis Program, where we have been able to provide now close to 500 district dialysis centers. Dialysis is provided free of cost to BPL patients and to ABL patients. Above poverty patients, it is at a very reasonable cost that we have to give. So these are some of the things. I don't know if you would be keen to read this, but what we recently also saw was getting the dialysis done is also a challenge. Like I said, those who are on dialysis would need dialysis every second of our day. So it's almost impossible for someone to carry so much and come back. So very soon we would be coming up with a program. So peritoneal dialysis is a thing that could do dialysis at home as well if you are trained well. So those training and providing those peritoneal things we would be supporting. Obviously that would reduce the outcome of an expenditure because the patient would be traveling, he would not be losing his stages by traveling out. The only constraint is that it has to be done twice a day. So I know some of the patients who are walking do the peritoneal dialysis once in the morning, once during the lunch time, and then in the night. And those patients who could afford, they would actually buy automated peritoneal dialysis machine cost in about 1.5 lakh rupees. Then you only need to do that dialysis once while sleeping. So makes your life easy. But I don't know how many BPL patients would be able to afford that. Neither the government at the state would be able to sponsor that kind of a machine to an individual patient. But certainly we are looking to sponsor vegan patient peritoneal dialysis in the future. So the policy to call the very conversation very soon should be announced by Honorable Minister. So these are some of the technology intensive policy I am talking to you in brief. If you would have any questions or any suggestions or comments, please feel free to give. I am available physically now. Otherwise, you could find me on LinkedIn, you could find me on Twitter as well. My name is Mohammed Ameel. I'm a good friend of Dr. Sanjeev as well. Although, much fun to those things. You could reach to me through him as well. And I'm sure may I have a good time, all the time. Yeah, although, initially, I was invited at 2:30, but I had someone at Dr. Sanjeev as well. So. But, please, in case you have any comments or any questions.
I just wanted to know, are the registered practitioners in the hospital, are they using the hospital?
So, for
the vaccination? For the
So, dialysis for vaccination. So, yes, so under the immunization program, the vaccination, that's a separate program which comprehensively do not look after. There are a certain set of vaccines which are provided to your hospital. But not all. So there are certain vaccines that we of course should check on ministry. And then one of the most important things is that health is a state service. So health services are not uniform for ministry because state has the more regulative because of the federal structure of the country. So this also you should know, there are certain subjects you read your constitution, so health, education are your state subjects. So it won't be uniform across. So some of the vaccines which are free in one state may not be free in another state. But the national policy is uniform. So the national government may say decide to provide free vaccine, support states to provide them for free, but some states should decide if they want to go for 7. Some states may say, okay, your financial support is okay, but I do not have human resources to provide them, so I only go for 4. So that kind of uniformity may not. So, good question. So, the guidelines is our center should have 5 machines to start with, but with more loads, for example, UPM, they have 10 machines. And for every 5th machine, 1 machine is reserved for a seropositive patient. So, seropositive patient is like someone suffering from hepatitis or HIV. So, 1 machine is reserved for that. You also have a health background?
Because it's a little public domain.
any other feedback if you think government are we providing any successful projects can be affected in providing the there are sort of startup supporting policies, but the thing is, it's not under the ministry directly. So there are a lot of ministries, so for example, Department of Industrial Policy, or Department of Pharma, which acts for Department of Science and Technology, Department of Biotechnology, should follow these ministries to support startups. Health Ministry's perspective has been to run their own hospitals and not to look around. I know what we're talking should also be a prerogative of the Health Ministry, but so far, supporting startups and all have been done by Department of Biotechnology, Department of Science and Technology, DIB, the President of Information Policy. So that should be important. Any other thing you would like to ask or maybe give a feedback? Was this session good, informative or so maybe we should give some time.
Done?
Yeah. Good.
Okay, thank you. I know you were having a lot of meetings till you managed to come.
No, right.
Thank you very much. Small from my heart.
देते हुए आप एक बार करो
organization as well from my last 2 years back. I heard of